So that was a terrific talk. You covered a lot, which is great. So I will skip through some of these slides that I don't want to talk about.
Not yet.
Really screwed things up. I'm very happy to be here, and there'll be questions at the end. So I'm going to talk for about 15 minutes so we have enough time for the speakers. I work at Columbia University. Columbia University is in New York City. You think New York City is ugly? It's not. Look at all the beautiful greenery. Here's Columbia Medical Center, the New York State Psychiatric Institute where I work. It's gorgeous, so you should come visit. And there aren't that many ticks there either. Okay. So you've heard about the different manifestations, facial nerve palsy, or your migraines, or your arthritis. Early you get the rash, and then you get the other symptoms coming a little bit later. Arthritis could occur within a few weeks, or occur more commonly 9 months later. And the neurologic signs, the cranial nerve palsy, can occur pretty quickly after infection. The effect of the peripheral nerves, and when it affects the peripheral nerves, oftentimes people feel numbness and tingling in their fingers or feet. They may have burning pains. They may have ridiculous pains, where the pains shoot across their abdomen, or it could be like a knife pain, like a sharp stabbing pain. It could go shooting down your leg like a sciatica, so sometimes it can be hard to distinguish from a sciatica. Or you could have central nervous system involvement. So actually pretty quickly after the tick bites you, the spirochete goes into the bloodstream. And within about 2 weeks, it actually has been documented to show signs of it up in the central nervous system. So it can get there quickly, which is why you want to treat it quickly if you notice signs of a rash. If you get a tick bite, you certainly should also consider treatment of the tick bite. Okay, so that's the classic bullseye rash. You've seen that. Here's a rash that doesn't look like a bullseye rash. This looks like a spider bite. So most doctors would say, this is a spider bite, let's ignore it, it'll go away. But actually, when this was biopsied and cultured, it was proven to be a Lyme rash. So the scary thing is that sometimes rashes that we don't think are Lyme rashes actually are Lyme rashes. So if you get an unusual rash during tick season now, or the summer, you should definitely consider the possibility that this might be Lyme disease, because it doesn't always look like Lyme disease. So this also is a Lyme rash here, a big, huge rash on the back. Those are the satellite where you get multiple rashes. And here's an oval-shaped rash. So you can see why it might be easy to miss. Okay, so we talked about the cranial nerve involvement with the facial palsy. You may also get other cranial nerves involved, where you might get double vision, or you might get hearing loss, or you might get visual loss. So there have been cases of loss of vision, and that's obviously quite scary. Later, or actually sometimes early on, you may get cognitive problems. And what's a cognitive problem? It's when you have trouble remembering. It's when you have a trouble finding the words to say what you want to say. Your brain feels like it's in a fog. And that's the way people come in. They say, oh, my brain feels foggy. I can't think clearly. My brain is going really slow, and you can't work as well. You get criticized at work. You start feeling bad. So something's off. And that's not uncommon at all. Cerebellar ataxia means loss of balance, and that can happen sometimes with Lyme disease. Sometimes it can look like a multiple sclerosis type picture where you have weakness, where you have inability to properly move your arms or legs. You could have severe headache type syndromes in children. It could be central nervous system Lyme disease. Rarely you may get seizures. So I'm a psychiatrist, so why would a psychiatrist be interested in this disease? Well, largely because infections that affect the central nervous system can certainly induce mania, they can induce depression, they can induce paranoia. And I actually have seen some patients where the first symptoms were not the rash and were not joint problems. The first symptoms were paranoia and then confusion and then being hospitalized in an ICU because of severe encephalitis. And then finally, the Lyme disease was recognized. So there are so many different manifestations to this illness, which is why it's one of the reasons it's a problem. It can mimic chronic fatigue, depression, MS, cognitive decline in children. It can look like attention deficit problems. It can look like willful misbehavior because they don't want to be in school because sound is really hurting their ears. So just being in the gymnasium is painful to them, or being in the cafeteria is painful for them. Or they're putting their head on a desk in class because they're so tired. Okay, so, and then you have the chronic symptoms, and that's really problematic because it waxes, and it's, first of all, it's disabling, so you don't function as well as you used to. Also waxes and wanes, so some days you look better, some days you look worse, and people start to accuse you of making it up. Family members get annoyed with you because one day you're feeling well, and then when you have to go visit the in-laws, you're not feeling well. It's very willful and suspicious. And it's really horrible because you can't plan. And because you can't plan, you can't move on with your life. So that's a problem. Then we have the blood tests that are helpful. It's important to get the blood tests, but they're not definitive. So that can be an issue. And then the treatment recommendations vary. So do you treat for 2 weeks, 4 weeks, 6 weeks? Do you do recurrent treatment? And then who do you listen to? What does the literature say? Well, my view of the literature is that repeated antibiotic treatments definitely can be helpful for many patients. Not everybody gets better from repeated antibiotic treatment, because there are many reasons why people might have persistent symptoms. But one of those reasons certainly would be persistent infection. So here's Job from the Bible, miserable because his neighbors are accusing him of making it all up. He was tormented with all these sores and lesions. And they said, you must be doing something wrong that's caused your illness. And that's what patients with chronic Lyme symptoms are told. So, okay, we talked a little bit about early Lyme disease, and the chronic is when you have repeated symptoms and you don't know why, and you've already been treated with antibiotics and the symptoms are persisting. And some people call it chronic Lyme disease. Other people call it post-treatment Lyme syndrome. And the doctor here is saying the bad news is you have Lyme disease. The good news is I don't believe in that disease, so you are fine. I don't know if anybody's had that experience, but that unfortunately is a state. I mean, some doctors are very uncomfortable dealing with ambiguity. And if there's ever an ambiguous disease, this is one of them. Other doctors are quite comfortable dealing with that. Psychiatrists especially are good at dealing with ambiguity because we don't have blood tests. So we listen to the patient. Patient device to describe a typical constellation of symptoms, we tend to go on that. Well, is there any evidence that chronic Lyme symptoms exist? Here's one study from Europe showing that if you had neurologic Lyme, you're much more likely to have attention problems, depression problems, arthritis problems, memory problems, headaches, etc. 3 years later. If you had early Lyme disease, you're much more likely to do very well 3 years later. So early Lyme disease rarely causes chronic problems. More systemic, severe manifestations of Lyme disease can do it. Okay, I'm going to skip this. So what are the causes? What are the areas of controversy? Well, one controversy is why in the world are people having persistent symptoms? Well, could it be that there's persistent infection? And certainly, over the last 5 years, I would say that there's been a revolution in science, in our understanding of Lyme disease. And that's because animal models in the United States, animal models in Europe have shown that the infection can persist in the animal even after antibiotic treatment. And it wasn't just one lab or two labs, it's been multiple labs now. So scientists believe this to be true because it's been repeated many times. Permanent damage, sometimes the arthritis can cause permanent damage, and synovectomy can be very helpful where you remove the synovium. Autoimmune causes can exist, and then there are other possible causes as well. Co-infection that hasn't been recognized. Okay, so here's all the different animals that have been studied where the spirochetes persist. Sometimes the spirochetes can be there, but they don't cause disease. That's another interesting mystery of this illness, which is that you can actually harbor the spirochetes, but you don't necessarily have to kill them because they're not causing any disease. Okay. So we also know that there's good evidence that some of these patients with chronic symptoms, they have hyperactivated immune responses. So now a number of doctors are showing a great deal of interest in and trying to modulate the immune response so that they might actually, patients may actually feel better. So intravenous gamma globulin is a treatment that's used for autoimmune neuropathies, and some patients with Lyme disease are reporting it to be helpful, although it hasn't been studied carefully. So there are a variety of tests that you know about, blood tests, spinal fluid tests. But one of the problems with the tests is the labs vary. So this was a study done by the head of the Lyme program at the National Institute of Health. And what she reported was, if you send it to the Mayo Clinic, 50% of the time the ELISA will be positive. If you send it to Stony Brook, 80% of the time. Well, what kind of a test is that? And why are the labs different? And again, the same kind of difference here, 75% positive, it's if sent to the New England Medical Center, and 50% of the time positive. No, this is Stony Brook, and this is New England Medical Center. So anyway, basically the point is that the labs vary in terms of sensitivity. There's another point, which is sometimes you can get a positive test that doesn't mean that you have Lyme disease, that you've been infected by Lyme disease. So the ELISA sometimes can be a false positive, especially if you, here's the false positive. Let's see. Yeah, false positive. If you had mono recently, 53% of the time you might have a false positive. If you have rheumatoid arthritis, 10% of the time it might be a false positive. And if you have syphilis, 85% of the time you might have a false positive test. So the tests are problematic because they don't tell you, number one, if there's active infection. Number two, if you do get a positive test, they can stay positive for a year or 2 years or 3 years, and it doesn't mean you have active infection anymore. What a problematic test. So you might get all depressed and go home sad, but you don't have to because there are newer things that are being done. Now, this is a really weird thing that's being done, where they're actually taking clean ticks and having the clean ticks feed on the human to see if the clean tick can suck up a spirochete. And this clean tick find the spirochete. That's called xenodiagnosis. And the reason they're doing this study is because it was shown in the animals that the only way you can really find the spirochete, find the bacteria of Lyme, is by doing this weird thing of having the tick feed on the previously treated mouse. And so here are the ticks having a nice happy meal. And is there good news? This is my last slide. Is there good news? Yes, there's good news. There's actually tremendous progress going on in vaccine development. And if there was an effective vaccine against not just Lyme, but the other co-infections as well, everybody in Dutchess County, your real estate would go skyrocket because it's so gorgeous up here, and you could be not worrying about Lyme disease. There's progress in diagnostic test development. We're starting a study where we're looking at this test called Spirofind, which is an assay that's developed and used now in Europe and in Germany, and it can actually be a marker of active infection. So if it's positive, the spirochete is there. If it's negative, what we understand, the spirochete isn't there. So we're trying to study that here in the United States. We'll be doing it here in Dutchess County, Martha's Vineyard, Pennsylvania, other places. And then there are a whole range of other tests as well. So the good news is science is finally bridging the gap between clinicians who have fought with each other, and people are now much friendlier with each other. And doctors are friendlier with each other. It's all going to do well in terms of serving the patients. We'll talk again.